some packs and stairs. Somebody give the Lord some praise. If you're glad to be in the house tonight, good to see you. And man, welcome to Compassion. Everybody that's watching online, welcome to you too. We're so glad you got here to come with us online. And at least you're here with us in spirit. So comment on there and let us know where you're watching from and who's watching for you. It's good to see you. Hope everybody's had a good week so far. Man, I hope you had a great Valentine's Day and enjoy time together with those that you love. I don't know about you, but here on Sunday, I just feel just wrong the way that we had such an amazing service Sunday. I was thinking, all the crowd, taking it a while, so you're going to see the numbers recovering back down and people getting back out and getting back in the house of God. We just saw a phenomenal move of God's Spirit Sunday. I've just been sort of testing all that in my spirit all week so far. So I'm looking forward to this. We're going to do something else tonight. And I don't know what you need, but I know that God's able to provide it for you. And then how do you know that God is able to provide every need? And then God's able to do all things, and all you need to do is just believe that God is able to do it. I'll just stand with you tonight. Our worship band is ready to bring us there into the presence of God with your worship. And I just want to invite you into this place. I just want to lift up the name of Jesus. Just see God do some amazing things in this place. Let's pray tonight. Father, we love you. We're so honored to be in the house of God again. Lord, we're so grateful for the way that you've blessed us and the way that you've invited us here. God, I want to come before you. Lord, I ask that you would just be with me on any day that we're in this place. But as always, God, you don't owe us anything. Father, we just come to you. We love you. We so trust you. We're grateful for your amazing grace. And tonight, Lord, we just give you praise. And we lift up the worship to the heavens tonight. We pray that you would come down. We love you, we praise you, we honor you, Lord, we ask you to be with us today in the church now. And we give us what you need us to know. Thank you.
Who follows Thank you.
Thank you. say, who's great will be saved by the blood of the Lamb? Amen. I'm on my way to heaven, and I'm so glad. I don't know that I'll ever get over this Holy Ghost field. Come on, somebody. I don't know that I'll ever get over it. I'm just thankful. If the Lord takes 100 more years, amen, we're going to be grateful and celebrating and shouting and rejoicing and giving God praise, but I don't know that He's going to carry that long. I'm here looking for Jesus to come back. Amen. This is your reminder that the Lord is coming back. I'm looking for Him. Amen. man, all these kids and students, and man, we love these guys, and it's so grateful for them, and I pray for leaders. If you have your Bible, you can go ahead and be getting ready in the book of Isaiah, but I want to share a few thoughts with you before I start reading our scriptures. I just want to say to you, welcome. It's always great to be in the house of God. It's our big week. It's kind of a big week. Reading your Sun Church is called it, or a big week recharge. I don't know if you want to call it that, but I think so. As I jump in this evening, I just want to ask you this one question. Would God ever put you in cyber prison? Would God ever just want to lock you up? Would God ever want to be, ever have a desire to put you in a place where he wants to detain you? I feel like we would all probably answer that question by saying no. But I believe that if we're all honest, there are times it seems like in our walk with God, just trying to serve God, that there are times that in serving God, it feels like you're just in a holding place or in a waiting area. Anybody ever felt like that besides me? I don't have to raise my hand. But, you know, I've felt like that so many times in my life that God has just had me kind of like holding, and I'm like waiting, but I don't know what I'm really waiting for, if that makes any sense to you. And so, I don't know, I just felt like that a lot serving God. Like, I just didn't know what was next or when next was, or what that would look like or what God would be doing. And I think that there's times that it seems like our lives are spinning out of control. I don't know about you, if you can relate to this or not, but we go 150 miles an hour. It seems like we never stop, we never slow down. And it's really, really hard to, you know, to kind of just, like, take a breather. I shared with you Sunday, for those of you who are friends on Facebook, Noel and I got to get out of town for just a couple of days and just have a little cabin break and all this. And, like, it takes us when we go on vacation, like, 3 or 4 good days before we can, like, de-church, if that makes any sense. Like, it's just in our blood, man. It's just that, you know, we're so passionate about the ministry and about what God's called us to do. Like, we're sitting there, you know, can't even have a normal dinner conversation because we start talking about church in like 2 minutes. And we just, you know, it's like, we're like, okay, we'll try to stop talking about stuff back home. It's just like, start trying to think about vacation mode. So it's like, I mean, it's just busy all the time, and I think a lot of you relate to that. And so it seems like, though, as we go through life, and even those things that seem like they are out of control, and like we just don't know what's coming next, you know, we kind of stand back and just scratch our head, and we're trying to figure out what the next move is, or rather, what God's next move is. What is going to be next in our life? How is this going to look? And we're just not sure what's coming. We're not sure what he's going to do. And I think that we can all agree that God is a very mysterious God. And that's a good thing, because I don't want a God or a servant God that I can figure out. I don't want a God who I know everybody is going to make a predictable God, because that kind of God would not be a step ahead of the devil like our God is. Come on, somebody. He's always prepared. He's always many steps ahead of our enemy. And I'm grateful that he's very mysterious. He does things in a way different way than many of us would claim. Many of us would even think that God would do it. I don't believe that God would just lock you in a prison to answer that question and be fair. But I think that God may, and don't miss this, I think that, God may sometimes detain you and I for a purpose. Not a prison, but I think that God may at times detain us for a purpose. And here's what we do, and I know y'all do it because I do it too. Is many times when we're waiting on God to do something in that waiting area, and I've had a sermon on my mind forever, I've got this huge, long sermon notes thing on my phone that I put random things in when God speaks to me throughout the end of my day. And the waiting area is not an easy place to be. Who likes to wait, man? You know, I go to Disney World, I'm about to rip all my hair out trying to wait 9 hours in line for one ride. Like, you know, I don't like to do that. You go to Texas Roadhouse or somewhere, and it's always like 45 minutes, an hour wait, and I'm like, oh, forget it, we're going somewhere else. You know, like, who likes to wait? Nobody likes to do that. And what we do is we get so impatient, and we jump the gun on God, and we start trying to do things for him and figure things out for him and trying to plan things and saying, okay, it's taking way too long, and then we do things too quickly, and we start to mess some things up. I love this quote. There is a Christian's ministry publisher who said, trust in God's timing. It's better to wait a while and have things fall into place than to rush something in your life and have things fall apart. It's so much better to wait and let them fall into place than to rush things and then just let things fall apart in your life. I think that there are times when we find ourselves caught up in sort of this vortex, if you will, of God's eternal plan. And like, it looks so huge and so powerful, and it is. But there are things that are going on in and around us all the time that we don't know, we can't figure out, we don't know what God is doing next. And then what happens is, it seems like it makes no sense at all. And then we try to quickly make sense of it in a season of confusing, almost chaos, right? We try to put an answer to it. Have you ever been there? Maybe you identify with this and you kind of know what I'm talking about. But you know that God is in control, but it's like you know that, man. We have prayer time, we're praying, God, you are in control of my life. I gave you my heart. Everything that I have belongs to you. You are the air in my lungs. You're the water that I thirst for, and I know you're in control. But it seems like to me that I have no idea what you're doing in my life right now. I have no idea what you're up to in the sense that, you know, this sense of unknown that I'm talking about, it bothers us deeply because we don't know what our life is looking like next. We don't know, and it's almost like this picture of going out into the middle of the ocean, you know, and like in this dark abyss that seems endless, and then you just like jump out in the middle of it, and like it's the thought of, to me, the first thing that comes to my mind is it's terrifying because I have no idea what's down there. I have no idea what's ahead of me or what's beneath me or what's all around me, and that is terrifying to me because it's unknown. Start trusting in God while He is temporarily detaining you because He is trying to align your destiny. Like you trust God whenever He's blessing you. And what I'm saying is, it's not too crazy to trust God even whenever He's blessing you. In other words, we trust God with the blessings and the good things of our life. We just don't necessarily always trust God whenever we don't know what He's doing. We don't always trust God when it doesn't feel good. It's easy to trust God when things are going well. It's harder to trust God whenever. Here are the scriptures, I hope you guys have time to get to Isaiah. Here are the scriptures that show us why we need to stop planning our lives and staying up at night with anxiety over tomorrow, whenever we serve the God who knows tomorrow. It doesn't do any good worrying and losing sleep and losing your mind over something you don't have the power to change to do. Here's what we're about to say, Isaiah 55, verses 8 and 9. Let's simply read to you. For my thoughts, the Lord told Isaiah, are not your thoughts, nor your ways are my ways, says the Lord. For as the heavens are higher than the earth, so are my ways higher than your ways, and my thoughts higher than your thoughts. Isaiah was kind of looking at this, so there's a few things here that we're sort of talking about. And I think what he's mentioning in this scripture as a whole, if you want to put this in context, is the circumstances of life can be so confusing. We know the circumstances sometimes are super confusing because they're given to you a lot of times unfairly. They're given to you at times to where you wouldn't choose that for yourself. And so, if we only looked at circumstances with our lives, kind of like what was happening here with Isaiah, I think that we would also be confused too. Because circumstances will lie to you. Circumstances look at you rather, and they try to tell you that your life is horrible or falling apart or a mess just because of what's going on around you. How many know that, and let me just encourage somebody right here by telling you that there may be things falling apart all the way around you. There may be like fires all the way around you, and you can still stand there and smile and give God praise because God can still work with that thing. God can still bless you in those moments. God is still up to something good, even when it looks like you're surrounded by negative things. And so your circumstances will lie and deceive you. And it reminds me of a really good movie from way back in the day in the 90s, with the exception of some bad language. There was an old 90s movie called Black Sheep with Chris Farley. Y'all remember him? They've gone too soon. They love that guy's a comedian. But there was a scene that he's going through in Black Sheep where he rolls down this mountain. He's going forever. He hits everything all the way down, and like for no reason, just from a little slip. And he gets to the bottom, and his hair's messed up. He's covered in dirt. He looks like he's just like been through a tornado. And he's like, what was that all about? You know, like, has anybody ever felt like your life was that way? You know, I felt like I've looked around at the season. I just came out of in my life and asked that same question, just like Chris Farley did. I'm like, what in the world? Like, how did that just happen? I was doing fine in life, and then all of a sudden, like, this just smacked me right in the face, right? And so, I mean, it seems like sometimes life is so unfair, and people even blame God because situations happen, and whenever things go on in their lives, like, you know, whenever we have a bad diagnosis at the doctor, and the first thing people want to do is blame God. Why? Because we say God is the healer. And when everybody, you know, somebody's having a difficult situation at home, they want to get mad at God, they want to blame Him. Why? Because God should be able to snap His fingers and make everything okay. And the first thing we do is blame the one that has all the power and all the authority to change those kinds of situations. And so we're asking the wrong questions. It's not why won't you do something about it. It's why don't we have enough faith to wait on God while He's working things out in that season. Because the Bible says that all things work together for the good of those who love and trust the Lord, those who are called according to His purpose. And that is a very important thing for you and I to remember. It's because God can use it. God won't bring something so awful on your life that He just wants to destroy you, but God will use it to be able to bless you in the end and turn it for your good. Amen? Life is hard at best. I mean, life is hard at best sometimes. And it seems like the believers carry greater burden than anybody on the planet. And let's consult a few of the tons of scriptures, by the way, about life. I'm going to give you four just straight in a row right here. Watch what your Bible says. Proverbs 18 and 10. The name of the Lord is a strong tower. The righteous run into it, and we are safe. Nehemiah 8 and 10 says, do not grieve, for the joy of the Lord is your strength. Amen. Isaiah 41 and 10 says, and so do not fear, for I am with you. Do not be dismayed, for I am your God. I will strengthen you and help you. I will uphold you with my righteous right hand. Last one. Exodus 15 and 2 says, the Lord is my strength and my song. He has given me victory. This is my God, and I will praise Him, my Father's God, and I will exalt Him. These are just a few of the main scriptures we can find in the Bible. Hang on. These are great scriptures. These are so powerful. But if, in fact, you and I can read these, and then the Bible tells us, look back up. The Bible tells us that if the name of the Lord is a strong tower, and you can run into it and find safety, that must mean that there is something out there to run from. If it says don't grieve, it must mean that there are things in life that we're going to grieve from. If it says don't fear, it must mean that there are things in life that are going to cause us to fear sometimes or be dismayed, as the scripture just said. If He has given me victory, hang on a second, if He has to give me victory, that must mean that there's a fight to fight out there. That must mean that there's something I'm trying to fight that I'm having to win and conquer and get victory. And so, and just because we feel like that we're saved and we serve God, it doesn't mean that everything is going to be perfect in our lives. In fact, the Bible tells us here in many scriptures that it's just that we are going to have purpose for this prison. It's going to be for a reason, in other words, that God is going to do it. It's a detaining area. And I believe that all these have the same thing in common. You know what these things all have in common? I believe that though life will hit us very hard sometimes, and sometimes things are very confusing, you and I don't always have the answers, and we wouldn't always bring the thing that comes, and that sometimes it's unfair. I believe, though, that God is still good, and He's also provided a way out through victory and peace and given you the joy unspeakable and full of glory. I don't know about y'all, but have you ever just been able to worship God and been so happy and joyful in your life? Even in those seasons, I'm not saying it happens all the time. Come on, we're being real. But in some of those seasons where it seems like you should be losing your mind and quitting church and throwing the Bible in the garbage can like you've just had enough and things have been crazy, and still you find joy somewhere in the midst of all of that. I mean, look at people who've been serving God for decades. Look at those kind of people. I love that because those kind of people have found out what it means to hold on in difficult seasons and not quit when it's easy. But when it's difficult, right? It's easy to quit whenever things are really hard. But for the endurers who go all the way to the end, I mean, they shout through the road and the crowd. I'm grateful to be an endurer. I'm thankful to know that God gives me strength to endure circumstances. Your circumstances that make them easy, but don't mistake them, though, for absolute failure. If God is in this place with you, then you are going to make it. If God is going through this battle with you, then it must mean that you're going to come out somewhere. Because God's not going to make it. What feels like our prison in the midst of God's purpose can also be a place of God's commitment. In Jeremiah 32, we actually find the Bible. Jeremiah finds himself in literal prison by Zedekiah, the king of Judah. And you can ask the question, hang on a second, why don't they God? Out in this physical prison over there. He was indeed confused, I believe, to say the least. He didn't understand what the Lord was doing in his life, but he made a decision with what to do in that prison. I mean, know that we have the choice to make whenever we find ourselves in that hole again. We're not waiting for this door to be prison. I'm not sure, maybe this God is telling you, but I'm not sure you are. The choice is up to us what to do with that. He could have quit. Yeah, he could have said, God, this is ridiculous. How in the world could you turn your back on me? But everything that I know to do, I pray every prayer that I know to pray, I was serving you faithfully. I don't understand why you would do this to me. used this time. And the Bible tells us that he had communion and personal growth with God, that he spent time with the Lord and he grew in his relationship. He praised the Lord for his greatness. He praised the Lord for his glory. He praised God for his power and for his past works. Amen. Let me tell you this. The first thing the devil will always try to get you to do when you're going through a difficult season is he will always try to make you forget what God has already done for you before. The first thing he does, it's like God will deliver us from 500 things in our life. But for one season, it's like all that is out the window. We've forgotten about all those things. We've forgotten about the goodness of God in all of those seasons back then. And God is standing there saying, it's the same thing that happened to the Israelites. I mean, as soon as they were delivered from, from Egyptian slavery, it happened over and over and over again. It's like this roller coaster with the Israelites, just like, serving God and then we're in worse battles. And we're serving God and we're giving up on Him. Like, it was just this constant thing of them serving God and then betraying Him. And then they want to come back when they're in trouble. And then it's like just, it's so frustrating. But it's exactly what many of us still do today because we have forgotten that God worked miracles before. It's a miracle that you are even saved. It's a miracle that your name is written in the Lamb's Book of Life. If you don't have anything you can remember to thank God for, give Him praise for that. If you don't know of anything else that you can lift up the name of Jesus for, remember that God has already done so much for you. The hard places in our life, they can affect us one of two ways, usually. They can drive us away from the Lord, like Cain, or they can drive us to the Lord, like Job. Cain was like running from God, and he was trying to get away from God, and he was like questioning and all these things, and it drove him away from Him. Job was a man who, the Bible said, he lost everything, and he still, he went through his moments. You can read the story of Job, and he went through moments where you can probably tell, like through his teeth, he was like talking about how great God was, but then he was kind of like, but you let all this stuff happen, And one thing I've shared with you guys many times, I love it, that God responds to Job, and He takes like two whole chapters to tell him, okay, Job, sit down, but you got a minute, good. Where were you when I formed the galaxies? Where were you whenever I said, let there be light, and the light was? Were you there whenever I made the heavens and the earth? Were you there when I formed the oceans with just a breath? Like, I can imagine Job's face. He's like, that's good. You don't have to. That's a real good point, God. All that stuff, just forget everything that I just said. I can just imagine what Job's face is like, because God takes two chapters to tell him, you weren't there and you didn't help me get anywhere where you are right now. Just save it because I'm sovereign and I know what I'm doing. The hardest places in life can drive us away to draw us closer to the dark. When you find yourself in one of those two places, whether it's detaining or holding place, all these experiences in life, I think there's no better thing for you to have to do than to pray and seek God. People ask me that all the time. People send me messages and call me like, Pastor, what am I supposed to do? I'm going through this thing. I'm going through this thing. And really, ultimately, I get counsel many ways and I share many different things, but it all comes back down to you need to pray a lot more. You need to seek God a lot more. People want some sort of magic formula. People want some other kind of answer. A lot of times, they want something to be quick that will just bring all the solutions. But yet, the Word of God will always remain in that we seek God. It always comes to seeking the glory of the Lord. Father, pray and fasting right now these 100 days. It will always be that we are just trying to seek and get a hold of more of the power of God and trying to get to the figure of Jesus as often as we can to save this word. Why to save this word? Because this right here is full of promises from the Word of God. This is not a cute story book. This has promises that you've got to hold on to that cause Him to work in this. When your marriage is falling apart, there's promises to you. Whenever you feel like the devil's gotten in a cycle of sin that you can't ever break or ever get victory, there's promises for you. When you feel like that you're not saved and God saved you and the devil's pulling back to you and your past and where you used to be around people, it's full of promises for you, family. And that's the reason why the devil is trying to keep you out of this, and he wants you to try to come up with other solutions to try to get your victory or get your praise when it will always be the praying and seeking God that will give you the answer. When we turn from those feelings, when we turn from those doubts, when we turn away from people, whenever we try to face God and allow ourselves to step into and teach steps that will get us into the presence of God and make that a reality. It's just like I believe what Hebrews says, 4:16. Let us, therefore, come boldly to the throne of grace, that we may obtain mercy and find grace to help in time of need. I'm so thankful for that scripture because I have to be reminded sometimes that I'll have to walk around the people, that I'll be cut boldly to the throne of grace. I'll have to walk around with anxious thoughts that lead me into depression. Being so far away from God and feeling like I just always need you to find it because I can come back to the throne of grace. God can bring you every resource that you will have ever needed or will ever need to come back to unlock the prison doors
whether it's from an enemy or from a loving standpoint, it is the same thing to be with you until you are ready to be next. And I'll say it again, God did not do this to you. God did this for you. And so many times you get that next on my list. I went to God and I'm like, I'll just do this to you. And God's like, you have no idea what I'm trying to do. So the prison of waiting and tarrying can also be a place of comfort for you. How you can find comfort in that place. I think that many people will find that the Bible going to the worst time of the day, all my works are going to be, by the way, to the place of the time, that's going to take place in those situations. How can you get any more comfort or confidence in that? When you find yourself in some of the worst places of your life, you can take comfort in remembering who our God is. Sometimes you have to be reminded of what kind of power you are. You're bigger. What God is doing for you. You are yourself. You may not understand that what God is doing, you don't understand everything that you're doing, but we can trust the fact that what God is doing, and that is going to come alive because God is doing it. So God is sovereign. He works out every single one of his plans. He has a plan for us, and we may not know what he's doing, but we can work it out. One second, but he does have a plan. God is never stupid. God's power ensures that our promise is at least we have. Not only does God have the power to declare what that future is, but I believe that the future that God has for us is what he provides for you to have this future. Amen. Ephesians 3, 20, I love the scripture, said, now to him who is able to exceedingly abundantly above all that we ask or think, according to the power that works. Works in you, that power works in you. And he is able to do exceedingly abundantly above all that we ask of him. If you have a need, you need to remember that God can do that. If you are facing a mountain, you need to remember that God knows how to do that. If you are walking in a very dark valley, you can always rest assured that God knows how to do that. How to get you out. There is not one single demon, there's not one principality, there's not one spirit, there's not one evil person on this earth that can stop what God has started. God always finishes what he starts. And it's just looking, for example, at the cross and realizing that with the cross is also an entertainment. It's Jesus Christ. His presence never leaves you silent. It feels like sometimes you're stuck just like so lonely, you're kind of in a public place, and you're just like, man, I'm so alone. And I don't even have a reminder of myself. Come on, I mean, no, there's something God's supposed to have to remind myself of the cross. I don't have to remind myself of it. You've got to get over yourself. Surely the presence of the Lord is here. Surely God is still moving. And surely God is still, you know, David says, surely give us the basis to honor me all the days of my life, and I will dwell in the house of the Lord forever. And I had to remember, like, you know, what David has said, you know, surely I've got to remind myself, surely there's goodness and mercy that's followed me all these days. And I know that God has got to be here in this place, and it's so dark sometimes, doesn't it? But we still know that God is going to be there. He's the light in the darkness. It is only in the dark that the light will stand out and shine the best. God speaks best in those places of light and still. Ask Elijah when he gets to heaven. He was not, God's presence and his spirit was not in the wind. It was not in the earthquake or in the fire. The Bible says that he was still small voice. I would say to you, why is prayer seeking God so important? Thank you. we probably have some time out in some festival. I can do that. But none of those other places. You know why? It's because the presence of the Lord has been something that has to be discovered somewhere. And that's the spirit of someone who has some quiet place that we have to get to. And you wonder why it's so hard to get there. Because that's where God speaks some things. That's where God speaks to you. That's where God makes things so much better because he reminds you of those promises over your life. There's no wonder it's so hard to get there. Because your enemy doesn't want you to get into that place when you hear this truth like that. And then I believe that there's nothing wrong with any of those things that I make but do. But the secret place is where we find God working in this in ways and thoughts that are so much greater about life. Here's what I want to tell you. When God is holding you somewhere, somewhere to see you, it's not the place you want to feel like it is. Nor it seems like it. Jonah thought he could outrun God. Jonah thought I could outrun God's power. His power was over my house. I can jump on a ship and I'll talk to him sometime. Not know what to tell an entire nation that they're a bunch of crazy sinners and they need to turn. They're then to turn and go, you know, and he's like, come on, I am not going to do that because this guy's going, there's no way. There's no way this is going to happen. He's running from his death and he jumps on a boat and tries to get as far away from where God is calling him to be. He tries so hard to get away. And then all of a sudden we find him being thrown overboard. Long, long story. I don't have time to tell my sermon tonight. But he ends up still getting spat up back on the shores of where he was supposed to be to begin with. Tarsus is out of the question. He's back to Nineveh where he's supposed to be to begin with. And now all of a sudden we see him condemnation. What I would probably dare say is the greatest important revival in the history of anything that we have in the history of the world. The condemnation coming to God. It's incredible. And it's all because he finally gave his hope. Here's why I want to tell you that. I think that God has a promise for your life. Everybody in this room, God has a promise for you. If you're watching online, you have a promise that you're laying on it. And sometimes it feels like there's a wrap in a gift, and it's got those tags on it. You ever seen those gifts before? Maybe you put those all the way through your kids where it says, don't let them put this in between your feet. You know, just keep his presence like that. And just make it so mad to see it too. I feel like that promise is so far away. But it's kind of like that. The serving God sometimes like it's going to be a while. I got a good gift for you. It's going to be a long time before it gets there. And I believe that's kind of what it is having our point in time in God. Let me speak this to someone right now. There is purpose for this. There's purpose in what God is doing. I mean, these prison life times, I think that what we're reading here in Isaiah is there's a great power that's circulating all around and just moving within you that God is doing something amazing. It's supernatural things that are happening. You just can't see it yet. Somebody said yet. Doesn't mean that you're denied that. Is he going to add things to your life? I mean, like, you ask all these questions, and you don't have to be concerned if God is going to work things out, because I believe that you're already coming. Before you step into that season, God's already worked it out. You don't have to say, God, I need you to get on it. I need to work on a plan. Make it happen. I got to get rescued from all this stuff. And God's like, hey, relax. Before you even step into it, I already have the answer. I have a solution before you have the problem. And just holding just sometimes holding you for that perfect time and waiting on you to show you how that you're going to get there. God is giving you a word this evening. I will be right in the midst of what you may feel like as a Christian to tell you what God's going to put this to. I'm grateful that what you go through is not just for nothing. I'm thankful that whatever I go through in life, it doesn't have to be for nothing. In fact, some of the most difficult situations I've ever been through in my entire life, I've been so much. I was not thankful for when I went through it. I mean, yeah. You don't go through life like white knuckling, you know, almost like this roller coaster from Hades, and you're like, this is awesome, I'm learning so much. You know, that never happens. But once you get through it, then all of a sudden you're like, man, there's a lot of things I would have done different, a lot of things I won't do again, and a lot of things I just learned from that season. It's never for nothing. Y'all know how you go through your life. Y'all know how you play. Y'all know how you continue to do the faith in God. Don't let a spirit of confusion, because God's not the author of confusion. Don't let a spirit of confusion try to cancel your faith in God. Whether God's doing something in your life, maybe that's in your marriage, maybe it's in your ministry, maybe it's in your career. It could be a relationship or just an opportunity that has presented itself to you. Just know that God may not be necessarily saying no to you, but what you need, the fresh question is about to come. Stop believing that God can't even listen. He does make a chance to yes, but he's just not coming yet. And they will tell you that you need to wait. We don't like to wait for life again. Choose what you're going to do this time. Choose what you're going to do while you wait. What are you going to do when you don't have an answer yet? To be the number one God's up to yet. How are we going to respond? That's all we have to do. You can get mad, you can get frustrated, you can quit, you can get upset with God, you can try to roll up your sleeves and say, hey, man, I'm tired, I'm so frustrated, that's not going to give you any problems. You can do all these things. And really, what God is trying to do is just take care of you in those places anyway. Or the second thing that you can do is not to do it's the power of God and the place of God and the place of God. Choose to praise Him in your way. Trust Him, even in the time of waiting. It's not easy to wait. It's not to stay in heart because we want to answer now. We realize this is not the way Christian generates from something that's quite slow to the kind of God and the best things that are made and work together. And then it's not easy. You can get a phrase of pizza and pop it in the microwave and it's not going to be used good. It's a nice, amazing roast that you can have like all day long. Trust in God's timing and let things fall into place. I want to make that point. Trust in God's timing. It's better to wait a while and have things fall into place than to rush something in your life and have things fall apart. His position will be for not for this person, but for a purpose that's going to be his purpose. We pray that the Father will ever come out and give you praise. That the image of a person will give you praise and the heart of glory. Even if it's in a place where we feel like they were being held or being told to wait for a little while, God, I pray that even while some of us could be there tonight, we can just very often wait here watching online. Let's pray that you would help us to have the mentality to not only ask the right questions while we're in that place, but also to have the right understanding while we're there. Not to question everything that we do or even if we don't know what's going on, but God, help us to have faith in you and trust in you that you're so good and know so much better, so much better than we do. You have the all-seeing eye, you have the great eye for you in our lives, but we don't know what's right in front of us. Sunday membership Sunday, and it's going to be a part three of our series. And don't miss it. Find somebody to come with you. It's going to be so great. Get here early. Like last week, lots of people were saying it's already 5 o'clock. It's Friday. They're not the front part of the fence over here. I said, well, we'll start at 10:30. Come in while and jump in the glory while it's being poured out. And then have to look for it Sunday morning with me. Looking for another move of God. Come expecting. Have a great week. And I'll see you Sunday morning.